Hi there. I would like to welcome you to the 2023 Natural Systems Agriculture Tour. So welcome. We're here at the Glenlea Research Station of the University of Manitoba. This is a 1,000-acre farm located on Treaty 1 territory and the homeland of the Métis Nation. And on this 2023 tour, we've got an exciting lineup for you. We're going to show you some of our long-term studies, but we're going to show you a whole bunch of other soil health studies, greenhouse gas monitoring studies, plant breeding studies, machinery demonstrations, etc. So again, welcome. My name is Martin Entz. I lead the Natural Systems Agriculture Program at the University of Manitoba. And so maybe we'll start with just quickly asking ourselves, what is natural systems agriculture? Well, when I think about the term, I think about Asian farmers 1,000 years ago and the history that I've read about them and how they used diversity and recycling and animal integration and ducks and fish and rice all in the same system. That's really exciting. And that's really what we're trying to do in our lab, is to bring as many of nature's processes into the agricultural system. That's a big job because we've kind of been going the other way for a long time. But anyways, we're trying, and thanks for joining us on this journey. So when we think about an experiment to try and understand how natural our agriculture is, it is really important to have a benchmark. So people like Wes Jackson from the Land Institute, who writes books like Farming in Nature's Image, tells us that one of the first steps to designing a natural system anywhere in the world is to think about what is growing naturally in the area, or what was there naturally before intensive cultivation. And so here in the Red River Valley, the natural ecosystem was meadows, tall grass prairie, some willows and shrubs which would grow, and then the prairie fires would suppress them. And so at the Glenlea long-term study where I'm standing here, we've created 3 1-acre blocks of tall grass prairie. And so these, for us, serve as a benchmark about what the soil system, what the biodiversity might have been like in a more natural state. So today is July 18th. So the big blue stem, which is the emblematic tall grass prairie species, is just elongating, and it'll probably get about this tall and then it'll head out. And we've got other native grasses, switchgrass, we've got Indian rice grass in here, and there's many other species that have invaded this area over the last 3 decades. So what have we learned about the native system here? One of the things is that the amount of soil carbon that has been put into the soil by these plants is about 30% greater than in any one of our agricultural systems. And so keep in mind that back in 1992, when we started this study, the soil carbon was all the same, all across this, 15-acre area or thereabouts. But since we've introduced the prairie, we've introduced a lot more carbon into the system. So that means that we have a challenge in our agricultural systems. How do we design them to try to mimic the carbon sequestration of this prairie? In the background, you can see some flags and some poles, and that's graduate students from entomology who are looking at the biodiversity of the prairie. They've got pitfall traps there where they're trapping ground beetles and other insects. And so we use this in a lot of different ways. When you come here in person, you'll see there's a lot of ant hills here that are actually, some of them are quite small, some of them are really tall. I had no idea ant hills got so big on the prairie. And so this has been a really great place to learn about some of the natural processes. So This is the first stop on our tour, the tall grass prairie restoration. So our second stop is to see a system that reflects what farmers in the area are doing. So this is a rotation that includes only grain crops. It has wheat and oats and soybean. And while many farmers, of course, will grow canola here, we grow, the oilseed that we grow is flax. And there's reasons for that. But so we have this four-year crop rotation. And if you look behind me, you can see the wheat looks pretty typical for a 2023 crop. It's been extremely dry. And I'll just go and show you all the crops. So here we have the wheat. Next door we have the oats. And again, a very typical crop. Next we have the soybeans. And they look pretty good for 2023. And over here we have the final crop, which is the flax. And we'll just pause here for a minute. And if you look into the flax, you can see that there's straw on the surface. And that depicts the fact that we have been no-tilling these crops for the last 4 years. So it's been very dry for about 7 years. And so even though this is a heavy clay soil and no-till is not the standard practice for this region, a lot of farmers in the area are tilling a lot less, and we've gone to complete no-till in this system. So the crops are very short. It's been extremely dry. We've had very little rain all year. So this looks pretty typical. I do want to show you another replicate of this system to demonstrate some of the challenges that we're experiencing in this system. So here we are in front of another one of our conventional grain-only systems. The reason we have more than one is because in this long-term experiment, everything is replicated three times. But if you look carefully into this wheat, you can see we have wild oats. And the reason we have the wild oats here is not because we forgot to spray a herbicide. The herbicide was applied, but these wild oats are resistant to group one herbicides. And so this particular replicate, which is probably 100 meters away from the one that we just visited, has this population of wild oats. And so even though our conventional grain-only system is functioning pretty well, we have good yields, we have, we've been no-tilling and conserving water, we have this herbicide resistance problem. And if we just pan over to the flax here, we can see exactly the same problem in the flax. We've got wild oats there that we can't kill. So what we're learning, if we pan over this way to the soybean, or if we just move the camera over to the soybean, we can see that we've got no wild oats in the soybean. And the reason for that, of course, is because this is a Roundup ready soybean, and that's interesting and that's important. But the lesson is that if we didn't have this Roundup ready crop in here, we would have very little opportunity to kill these wild oats with herbicides. And so I'm telling you this because this represents a threat to this farming system. The fact that the chemicals that we use to control the weeds are not working as well as we want to, and we're down to some of our last few good chemicals. So when we think about natural systems agriculture, we definitely see a niche here emerging, and that is for these herbicide-resistant weeds to threaten the system. So we probably need to make a change here, even beyond just growing the soybeans. So on our journey to making conventional agriculture more natural, one of the steps that we can think about is introducing perennial plants into the rotation. That's not a new concept, but it is important, and it helps us go a certain way to mimic that grassland that we looked at. And in this rotation, that's exactly what's happening. This rotation includes 2 years of alfalfa grass, and then we grow wheat, and then we grow flax, and then we go back to alfalfa grass for 2 years. And that's what's been happening since 1992. Now, what are the benefits of having introduced this perennial? Well, one is that the amount of nitrogen fertilizer that is added to this rotation relative to the one that we just saw with that only has grains is half. So we're adding half as much nitrogen fertilizer here as we are where we just grow grains. And the reason for that is that the biological nitrogen fixation of the alfalfa supplies a lot of the nitrogen to this system. So that's really important. The second thing we've learned is that the alfalfa, by virtue of its deeper root system, does improve water infiltration and improve soil health parameters. Thirdly, if you look carefully at the wheat and at the flax, you will see no wild oats. And these plots have been sprayed exactly this with the same kind of herbicides that the grain only one has been. But why are the wild oats not here? And we are in a patch that has the resistance threat here than over there where we just grow grains. The reason is that the 2 years of alfalfa cut for hay are a very effective way of controlling wild oat weeds. And so that is the reason why we just don't have as much weed pressure. So by having a more diverse rotation with perennials, we've reduced the niche for wild oats to take hold here, and especially herbicide-resistant wild oats. And then finally, if we look at the crop, like that flax crop, you can see that that crop looks much better in this rotation than where we just have annuals. And that's partly because the soil health here is better. Flax is an excellent crop to detect soil health factors. Flax interacts with the soil biological system very intensively through its mycorrhizal fungi and other mechanisms. And if the soil isn't happy, the flax isn't happy. And this flax here shows us the soil is pretty happy. Okay, so that's the first step into making our grain production system more natural. During the course of the field day, you're going to learn about cover crops and other things that allow us to do that. I want to show you another example. So the next step in becoming more natural is to remove the pesticides and the fertilizers completely from the system. And so that really takes us to organic agriculture. And so those are the last two rotations that I just want to share with you this today and on the tour. So this rotation is, again, has 2 years of alfalfa cut for hay, then it goes to wheat and then to flax. And so here we are in the flax crop, and you can judge for yourself how it compares to the conventional. It was seeded later, and that's one of the reasons why it's not quite as thick. We've only got the beginnings of flowering happening. A lot of the plants are just in the bud stage, so keep that in mind. But the larger story here is, what are we doing to sustain this organic system if we're not adding any fertilizers and we're not adding any herbicides? Well, in terms of fertilizers, what we're doing here is we're bringing nutrients from livestock production and from urban centers back into agriculture. What we've learned is if we don't do that, the system doesn't do very well. And I'll show you an illustration of that in a moment. Compost that we use to enrich the nutrients in this soil are one-third beef composted beef cattle manure, one-third insect poop, it's called frass, and one-third anaerobic digestate. You will be hearing a lot more about anaerobic digestate in the future because it is a product of biogas production. And it is, all three of those are certified organic. So they are very, very critical to sustaining this rotation. But if we look at the flax and you look at the whole plot, I should tell you that one half of this plot is treated with the nutrients and the other half is not. But in the flax crop, you can never really see where the compost has been added because flax can gather its own nutrients from the soil through its mycorrhizae. and it's not so dependent on those nutrients. But other crops in the rotation are. And we'll go look at those right now. The crop that is requiring the compost in the organic system is wheat. And when you look at the organic wheat plot here, you will see that the front half of this plot doesn't look very good. The back half looks much, much better. And in the back half of the plot is where we've been adding that compost mixture once every 4 years in the rotation cycle. So what we've learned in this, after 32 years in this organic system, is that the recycling of nutrients is absolutely critical to sustain these organic systems. We've also learned that having the perennial alfalfa in the rotation is really critical to supply the nitrogen. This discussion around nutrients and organic is really critical. Just this morning, I read a paper from Europe saying that if the Europeans are going to achieve their goal of 25% of their land base managed organically by 2030, they need to get more serious about recycling nutrients back into the farming systems, because fertilizers are important. And so the idea of anaerobic digestate is really gaining strength, where we take municipal waste, use the methane to produce electricity or natural gas, and then the digestate goes into agriculture as an organic fertilizer. Final point on this rotation is that, surprisingly, maybe to some, is this forage grain organic rotation has, where we add the compost, has the best soil health of any arable system in this study. And in the surface layer, the soil health, both of the unfertilized and the composted, mimics the prairie. Why is that? It's not just the addition of the compost. It's probably because the biology of the soil is more active in these organic systems, because it has to be, because we're not adding those soluble, readily available nutrients. So this is something that we keep tracking, but it's a hopeful sign that trying to become a bit more natural does lead to soil health benefits. The rotation that we had just visited, which has the alfalfa in the rotation, the compost, and which is managed organically, has been a real winning rotation. It's not without its challenges, but even in a dry year like this, where we had to do pre-seeding tillage to control the weeds, we got a good stand, we have good crops, and that's due to the soil health. The other rotation system we have here doesn't have any planned alfalfa phases. So keep in mind that we're in the 32nd year of organic production here, and this rotation includes only grains. So we actually grow a green manure, and then we have wheat, and then flax, and then oats, and then back to the green manure. And this rotation doesn't give us the kind of wild oat control that we get out of alfalfa. And you can see this flax has wild oats. It's not a bad flax crop for organic production. And it's done surprisingly well this year. There's some other features of this rotation, which I'll explain in a minute, but I thought I would start just by having you take a look at this organic flax crop. And remember, flax is a very good indicator of soil health. And over here, the soil is reasonably healthy and the flax crop is doing really well. It's only now coming into flower. And so this probably will be not a bad crop. Okay, let's go take a look at another crop. Here is the oats in this grain-only organic rotation. And this is a really nice oat crop. We've had very challenging conditions this year because, like I said, in organic agriculture, we've tended to till before seeding. And then in a year like this, you know, we dry out the seed bed and we seed right away that day or the next day. And the oats is a very resilient organic crop, and it's done really well here. The back half of the plot looks a lot worse than the front half of the plot. And I now have to tell you that After about 20 years of this rotation, we split the plots and one half got a 5-year alfalfa stand. The other half we kept in the same rotation. And what we're looking at here, this beautiful oat crop, is the half of the plot that had the 5 years of alfalfa. And so that's the story of the of how we tried to make this system more economical. So this is Kongsor oats. This is a variety that was developed specifically for organic production by the Agriculture Canada breeding program at Brandon, Manitoba, in collaboration with the University of Manitoba, and it looks really, really great. Okay, we're going to move to another plot and tell you another story. Now, one of the problems with this rotation is, well, there's many problems with it. There's weed problems, there's nitrogen problems, and that's why we had to go to the alfalfa here. But because we're using tillage in the springtime to control our weeds, we can run ourselves into trouble. And that happened in a number of the crops in this rotation, including our green manure. This was supposed to be our green manure year, and we needed to control some weeds. We had some thistle in here, and so we've had almost no rain this year. We've had maybe 25 millimeters over the course of 2 months. And so instead of growing a green manure, we used what we call the mulch transfer system. We actually have been experimenting with this idea where we take a third of the land base in an organic grain-only system, and we chop the alfalfa and we put it onto the land as the green manure phase. And now we're going to wide blade cultivate this to try to get these thistles out of here. So that's just an illustration of some of the challenges of this organic system, and a little bit of an idea of how we're trying to deal with it. We need to do a better job of direct seeding in the springtime in the organic system, but then we have to balance that with weed control. So ultra early seeded spring wheat might do the trick. Maybe we should go to a winter wheat. Maybe we should go to a fall rye. So these are, or maybe a winter camelina as a crop that we can establish in the fall. So this organic system doesn't function as well as the one with the alfalfa. And I think because we have just opened up too many niches for weeds, and by controlling them, we've used our soil water inefficiently. So that's the first stop on the tour, is looking at this long-term rotation. I've shown you some of the good, some of the bad, some of the ugly, and that's really what the purpose of this study is to find out what's working, what's not, what are the knowledge gaps, how can we improve systems. So thank you very much for participating in this tour.
This is our wide blade cultivator. It's also known as a noble blade, and as you can see, it has one large blade the back, and it has a cutting coulter in the front that cuts through the soil, and the blade slides underneath the soil, and then as it moves forward it is able to cut off the roots of the weeds or plant material that is growing there. This causes the plants to dry out on the surface and die, and we found that this works the best when the weather after you use the wide blade is hot and dry, and so it really dries out the material really quickly and kills everything off. This is a great tool to use when you have a low moisture in your soil, like in a drought situation that we are in this year and have been in for quite a few years in this region of Manitoba. There's a lot less disturbance to the soil, and the soil doesn't dry out as much as more aggressive forms of tillage.
Hi everyone, my name is Laetitia. I'm from Kenya. I'm a second year master's student here at the University of Manitoba, working with Dr. Martin Entz. I'm also part of the ClimateSmart program that's offered by the University of Guelph. And as part of my research, I am looking at a field study here at the Glenlea long-term rotational study. And here I've been looking at the effect that the long-term manure addition has on some of the crop species that are grown in the organic rotation. Although the The study began in 1992. Since 2007, they introduced manure addition to their organic plots, and I'm looking at what changes has occurred since that time. The rotation that I'm looking at is, we call it the grain forage rotation, which has flax followed by 2 years of alfalfa and then wheat. And the organic plots are divided into two, so half has manure addition, half doesn't. So looking at what are the difference in terms of biomass, in terms of mycorrhizal root colonization, and also the phosphorus plant uptake, because the manure addition came in as a solution to the phosphorus deficiency that has developed over the years. And so looking at the characteristics since the historical data, I guess, since 2007. So for the wheat and alfalfa, I'm looking at the biomass and the yield since 2012, so 10 years ago, how that has been behaving between the three treatments, the organic with manure addition, organic without manure addition, and conventional, which acts as a control in this case. For the flax, in addition to yield and biomass, I'm also looking at the mycorrhizal root colonization and comparing that between the organic manured and organic non-manured. Some of the preliminary results so far has been the addition of manure has increased the yield and even the biomass in wheat and alfalfa, but it didn't work the same when it came to flax. And part of the reason could be flax being a very depending on mycorrhizal for its nutrients absorption, and also just being overpowered by weeds, because with manure addition came increase in weeds, and flax being a very weak rooted crop did not compete enough. So when it came to mycorrhizal in the flax plots, the organic side had less mycorrhizal population compared to the non-manured plots. So which means basically with manure addition came increase in phosphorus, and so there was no need for mycorrhizal to be in the area. And in the non-manured side, plants needed help with absorption, and so because of insufficiency in phosphorus level, there was need to have an increased population of mycorrhizal for the nutrient uptake. So basically, I think what we can conclude is that flax as a plant relies on mycorrhizal and does well actually in soils with low phosphorus level, because that then encourages mycorrhizal population. I'm here in the flax plot. This is a conventional plot, and I'm going to share with you how I've been collecting the biomass. So in the plot, we at the beginning, at the both ends of the plot, randomly selected two spots, and I'm using the quadrant method, which is 0.5 by 0.5 meters. So this is the area that was sampled for biomass. And also, as you can see in the middle of it, I took some soil samples, which was taken at the before, like in the fall before the planting, and also after, and that's to see the changes in phosphorus level before and after fertilization. As I mentioned before, the organic plots here are divided into two, the manured and non-manured side. And right now I'm standing in the flax plot, and on my left, this is the manured side, and then on my right, this is the non-manured side. Some of the differences, we can clearly see the non-manured side actually looks better than the manured in terms of plant height. The plants are just taller in the non-manured side, and also there are less weeds. One of the common weeds we have here in the flag plots is wild mustard. So in the non-manured side, because of low fertility, there's less weeds. Then on the manured side, we have a higher number of the wild mustard weed, and also the plant generally look less healthy or less taller compared to the other side. So that just shows how flax as a plant relies more on mycorrhizal for its development.
Hi, my name is Michelle Carkner and I'm a PhD candidate with the Natural Systems Agriculture Lab here at the University of Manitoba. And I'm actually standing in our organic wheat plot that has manure added to it. And I wanted to talk a little bit about the varieties that we grow here at the Glenlea Organic Rotation. We always try to do our best to manage each conventional and organic system to the best of our abilities. And part of that is picking the right variety. So we are growing two different kinds of varieties in the wheat rotations between organic and conventional. In the organic rotation, we're actually growing a farmer-selected population. Before I was a PhD student, I actually managed the participatory plant breeding program that we ran out of the lab, and we collaborated with over 75 farmers in wheat, oat, and potatoes across Canada. And so essentially, we were creating a connection between plant breeders in Canada and farmers. So the plant breeders would take their F3 generation, where they had very, very diverse plants, and we would send them out to the farmers to grow in their own fields under organic conditions. Organic breeding is gaining a lot of popularity because of the recognition of the importance of the selection environment in which the plants are grown in during the breeding process and the final environment through which the plants are being grown. So right now, a lot of organic farmers don't really have that much choice in what varieties they grow for their organic production systems when they're organically bred. A lot of organic farmers are actually growing varieties that were bred under conventional systems. And a lot of times in conventional breeding programs, they're supplied with ample fertilization, ample fungicides. They have herbicides applied to them, and so they're just not under the amount of stress that the plants will eventually be under in organic systems. So again, the variety that we're growing in the organic is a farmer-selected population. And we say population and not necessarily variety because we're still dealing with a diverse set of plants here. You can see the differences in height between these different plants that the farmer selected. You can see here, this one is just over a meter, and this one over here is just under a meter. But if we have different genetics going on within a population, then that's a little bit of an insurance policy against different environmental stresses like nutrient deficiency or a lot of weeds or drought conditions. And we are definitely seeing that in another project that an undergraduate student is working on, looking at drought resiliency between irrigated and non-irrigated plots. So let's move over to our conventional plots to see what variety we've decided to grow there. So I'm standing in the conventional long-term rotation plots now, and you can see that the wheat here is quite a bit shorter. That's because we like to plant varieties in the conventional in accordance to what farmers are growing right now. And right now, one of the most popular varieties that farmers are growing is Starbuck. So it's a semi-dwarf wheat, and it has good midge tolerance. And you would think that maybe the varieties that do well in conventional should do well in organic, but we've seen in multiple experiments that we've done within our lab that a lot of times the varieties that do well in conventional don't necessarily do well in organic. Because of the height, we've definitely seen this in AC Brandon, which is also a semi-dwarf, which we have a lot more experience with because this is a fairly new variety, that these semi-dwarf varieties are not necessarily the best for weed competition and early vigor. We've also seen that the coleoptile length is a bit shorter than some non-semi-dwarf varieties, which means that if you have to seed deeper because of moisture problems in the springtime, then those plants are not as vigorous and come up as quickly than plants that have a longer coleoptile, which is incredibly important for organic farmers because you really need to get ahead of the weeds as early as possible, and having early vigorous plants is essential. So I'm standing in our organic oat crop here at the Glenlea long-term rotation, and the oats are a bit different from the wheat because we've been able to collaborate with Dr. Jennifer Mitchell Fetch at AAFC, who's now retired, now the oat breeder is Kirby Nielsen, who we also work with, in their organic oat breeding program. So what I'm standing in front of is AAC Kongsor, which is actually the second organically bred registered oat variety that has come out. Our lab has collaborated heavily on the organic oat breeding program, so we're very excited about this variety. So this variety has actually been selected in the early generations, so when the plants were very young, between F3 and F5, under organic conditions that we helped manage and across other organic environments in the prairies. And so this variety really stood out in our organic trials. So then Jennifer decided to put them into the co-op trials to see how they do conventionally. And lo and behold, this variety did extremely well under conventional management as well. And so this variety has really good leafiness, so it has good weed competition in organic. And it also yields very well in organic as well as conventional. Another good quality about this variety is that it has good beta-glucan and dietary fiber. In oats, the quality of the grain is just as important as the agronomic, because a lot of times companies will use that beta-glucan quality in their labeling as heart healthy. So we're very excited to be able to grow the same variety in organic as well as conventional because it's been bred under organic conditions and we know it does well in conventional. So that's really great news. I'm standing in the conventional oat plots now, and again, we are growing AAC Kongsor in the conventional as well as the organic. And I just wanted to come here to show what Kongsor would look like under conventional conditions. This year has been very dry, so there isn't a huge difference between height in the organic versus conventional. Sometimes we do see that. There is really good greenness, but I just wanted to show you that some varieties that were bred under organic conditions can actually look really good under conventional as well. Organic farmers are not growing varieties that are well suited to their growing conditions, and so that has been partly a reason why we started this a participatory plant breeding program. Having worked with over 75 farmers in our participatory plant breeding program, we have a lot of farmer populations that have been selected under a wide range of different environments across Canada. And we've been running different experiments, including different experiments in my own PhD program, that have shown that a lot of the farmer populations can actually yield better, can actually yield the same, if not better, than a lot of the registered varieties that are available to organic farmers right now. And I think that this really drives home the importance of selection environment and also the potential for farmers to collaborate with breeders to serve parts of the agricultural community that may sometimes not be serviced or forgotten about in mainstream breeding programs. Hi, my name is Michelle Carkner, and I'm a PhD candidate with the Natural Systems Agriculture Lab at the University of Manitoba. And I'm standing here with Grace, who's our undergraduate ClimateSmart Soil student for the summer. And you're working on a summer project, right?
Yes.
And what is the project called?
It is looking the effect that soil health has on water resilience in different kind of cropping systems we have here at Glenlea.
And so at the Glenlea Long-Term Research Station, what are the three rotations that you are looking at in terms of water resiliency?
So all three of the treatments are within the perennial rotation that we have here. And the three treatments are organic, non-manure, organic with manure, and then conventional.
So when you say perennial rotation, what do you mean by that?
That this rotation has 2 years of alfalfa followed by wheat and then flax.
How are you measuring water resiliency in these three different cropping systems?
So within each plot, I have two subplots, one that has received water and then one that hasn't.
Okay, so how have you been irrigating the irrigation plots? Just with a watering can?
Yeah, just with a watering can, but I've had pre-measured, like I've been measuring the amount of water that I've been putting on within the watering can.
Okay, and so since the start of the experiment when you started irrigating until now, how much precipitation has the irrigated plots received?
They've each received 14 centimeters of water, so that's about 5.5 inches.
So would you say that that's about a normal amount of precipitation that a good year would be here in Manitoba?
Yeah, so we obviously haven't put rainout shelters on any of the irrigated plots, so they've also been receiving any precipitation that we've had this year. So irrigated and non-irrigated plots have both received about 3 centimeters of water, but then on top of that, my irrigated plots I've been adding supplemental water to, so the irrigated plots have probably received total about 17 centimeters of water, while the non-irrigated plots have probably received about 3 centimeters.
And would you say that it's been a really pretty dry, hot year?
Yeah, it's been really dry. We're having a drought this year, so.
Okay, so it's pretty good timing for your experiment.
Yes.
Okay, so where are we standing in front of right now?
Right now we are standing in front of an organic plot that has received manure. So,
and how long has the manure been applied? For about 10 years?
Yes.
Great. So we're standing in front of your organic manured plots. Mm-hmm. And so when you talk about resiliency, what are you trying to capture here with your irrigated and non-irrigated plots?
So I'm looking at the differences between the two plots, the irrigated and the non-irrigated plots. And if we assume that the irrigated plot is the most ideal conditions that the plants could be receiving, looking at the differences between the two, a smaller difference would most likely indicate that the non-irrigated plants could keep up with the most ideal conditions that the irrigated system would be receiving, or the irrigated subplot would be receiving.
Okay, and so what kind of organic practices or conventional practices would be thought to impact the water resiliency of these different cropping systems?
So there could be, I guess, a few differences. I mean, namely between the organic plots, just that one of them is receiving manure, which would be inputting a lot more nutrients into the system, whereas in the non-manured system, it's obviously might be much more nutrient deficient. And then in the conventional system, it's obviously receiving nutrient inputs as well. So that would impact the resiliency between the two plants, or some of the differences that we might be seeing. And then also within our conventional system, it is receiving much less tillage than the organic system is receiving.
And maybe also adding manure to the organic system might also impact the soil health,
yeah,
and resiliency against drought.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're standing in front of the non-irrigated portion of the organic manure, and I have here a meter stick so that we can give the viewers an idea of the heights that we're looking at. So if this is about 100 centimeters, you can see that generally a lot of the plants in this plot are about 100 centimeters.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're going to move over to the irrigated side, and we'll look at the height differences and the color differences in that one. Okay, so we're standing in the irrigated manure organic plots. Mm-hmm. And what can you tell me the differences between the plants that we saw non-irrigated and the plants that we're looking at now?
So there is quite a bit of a height difference, or at least a noticeable height difference between the plants. A lot of them are well over a meter tall. Mm-hmm. Compared to the non-irrigated plants.
They also look greener.
They do also look greener. Mm-hmm. That could be because, you know, the water that they're receiving is helping them take up some of those nutrients from the manure.
Yeah. I'm also noticing that, you know, these plants look pretty diverse. Like, why is that? Normally you'd see a lot more a standard height.
Yeah, so this variety is actually a population that was selected by a farmer through the PPB
participatory plant breeding program?
Yeah, program that is our lab has been part of.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, this is a much more variable population.
Diverse population.
Yeah.
Which might add to the bit of resiliency.
Yeah, it could, yeah.
Okay, cool. We'll move over to the conventional plots and see how the conventional is looking.
So where are we standing now, Grace? We are standing in the conventional plots.
Okay. And so this wheat looks a lot shorter than the organic.
Yeah, so this is actually a different variety. This is Starbuck wheat. It's a semi-dwarf variety,
so it's expected to be a bit shorter,
yeah.
And we're standing in the irrigated or non-irrigated plots?
This is a non-irrigated portion of the plot, yeah.
Okay, and so what you're interested in is the difference between irrigated and non-irrigated. So let's move over to the irrigated and see how that wheat is doing.
Yes.
Okay, so we're staying in the irrigated now.
Yep.
Quite a difference in height.
Yeah, it is quite a bit taller, obviously, than the non-irrigated section. And it is also quite a bit greener.
Quite a bit greener.
Yeah. So again, just like the other plots, probably because since it did receive supplemental water, aids in the plant uptake of nutrients. So mm-hmm. Yeah, it did. These plants would have received an input of fertilizer
as well. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's a lot easier for the plants to take up.
Yeah.
A little bit more green. And so when you were taking your height differences before, what was the height difference between the manure organic, between the irrigated and non-irrigated?
So the difference was of about, I think, 7 centimeters. And the difference with the conventional plants is actually almost, I think it's about 11 centimeters between the irrigated and non-irrigated.
Right. Because we can't compare the irrigated organic and the irrigated conventional because, like,
they're obviously different varieties. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a semi-dwarf, so it's going to be shorter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's just the differences between the two plots. The difference within the organic with manure, as I said, was about 7 centimeters. So that's obviously much less of a difference than in the conventional, which is about 11, I think.
That's great.
So, yeah.
Okay, interesting. And then at the peak NDVI, which was probably just before flowering or booting at the end of June.
Yeah.
What was the NDVI difference between the organic and the NDVI difference between the conventional plots?
They were very similar, actually.
Oh, okay.
So they were both getting values of about 0.8, which for those of you who don't know, NDVI is done on a scale and it averages across the whole plot. And so
it measures the greenness?
The greenness of the plot, yeah. So an NDVI of 0.8 is very good. I think the max that an NDVI value can be 0.9. And it's on a scale from like 0 to 0.9. So yeah, those values are very good.
And then the manure organic, what was it?
It was about the same as the conventional.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I think most of them were about 0.8 as well.
And what about the conventional non-irrigated?
I think they were scoring quite a bit lower. Anywhere from between, I would say, 0.65 to 0.7 something.
Okay, and then the organic manure?
Similar.
Okay, and so then we're going to look at the plots soon, but just for comparison, in the organic non-manure, what were the ranges of NDVIs in that one?
So they were actually, the non-manure irrigated was scoring about the same as a non-irrigated conventional or manure.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Okay. And so then in the non-irrigated, non-manure plots,
yeah,
were they about 0.5?
Yeah, I would say they were about 0.5, high 0.5, or low 6.
So that gives us an idea of just how healthy these different rotations were over the course of the season. Okay, great. Thank you. Okay, so now we're standing in the organic non-manure plots.
Yeah.
And judging from the meter stick here, you can see that the non-irrigated section of the plot is quite a bit shorter than even the non-irrigated manure organic.
Yeah.
So that's really interesting. Why do you think that is?
Just because, you know, there's so much less nutrients. This part of the plot hasn't received any manure. Mm-hmm. So there's obviously a lot less nutrients for the plants that are available. And furthermore, they don't have any water. So any nutrients that are within this plot, they still aren't very able to readily take them up.
But in organic, can't you just plant a alfalfa or like a pea oat and then that gives it nutrients? Like, isn't that enough?
Not necessarily, because if the plot is deficient in phosphorus,
which is what we see here,
which is what we are probably seeing here, even though the legumes are planted, because there's not enough phosphorus for them, they can't put back any nitrogen into the soil.
Fix enough nitrogen?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, let's move over to the irrigated and see how those are doing. So we're standing in the irrigated non-manure organic plots.
Yeah.
And I've got my trusty meter stick here, and you can see that a lot of the plants have reached 1 meter, so they are healthier than the non-irrigated.
Yeah.
And why do you think that is?
Again, it's just probably due to the fact that because they've received water, whatever nutrients were available to them in the plot, it's just made it a bit easier for them to take up those nutrients up as opposed to the non-irrigated plots.
Okay. And they still don't look as green as the conventional.
No.
Or the manure organic.
Yeah, no, they're not as green, so.
So replenishing your soil is pretty important.
Yeah.
Even if you have enough moisture.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And so what can you tell me about the differences between this section that has no irrigation and this section? Can you see, is there a big difference in height and greenness?
No, so there's actually not as big of a height difference as you might expect.
Judging from the other plots that we've been looking at.
Yeah, so between the organic with manure, and I would say also the conventional, there is a greater height difference between the irrigated and non-irrigated plots, whereas in the organic with no manure, there's much less differences in values. Oh, they're pretty close together, actually.
Okay. That's interesting.
Yeah.
So now we've looked at irrigated, non-irrigated, manure, organic, mm-hmm. conventional, and non-manure organic.
Yeah.
And judging from what you've seen so far, the measurements you've taken so far, and the differentials between irrigated, non-irrigated, and you're obviously going to take yield at the end, so you'll have that data to work from. Which system does it seem like is the most resilient against the drought conditions that we've seen this year?
Yeah, okay, so despite the fact that the non-manure irrigated and non-irrigated has much less of a difference between, let's say, the height of the plants or the NDVI value, that's probably just because the non-manured plot is so limited in its nutrient uptake. So just because there's less of a difference between them doesn't suggest that it might be the healthiest or highest yielding plot. But between the conventional and the organic with manure, the organic with manure actually has much less of a difference between the two irrigated and non-irrigated plots in comparison to the conventional. Mm. So that could preliminarily suggest that the organic with manure might have a bit better water resiliency or stress resiliency than the conventional.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Well, we look forward to your report.
Variety development for organic agriculture is something that we have thought about for a long time. And so what I'm standing in is an evolutionary population of wheat. I'm going to show you some features first, and then I will explain how we got here and why this might be a good idea. If you look at the wheat, here is a head that has no awns. Right next to it is a head that has awns. And if we look down in the canopy, we see some plants that are short and some plants that are tall. What happened here? Did we make a seeding mistake? Well, we always make a lot of mistakes, but in this case, we didn't. The idea of evolutionary wheat breeding is not a new one. It's been done in ancient times and certainly been done in the last 30 years in Europe for organic production. And the way it works is that you take a lot of different parents, you cross them, you get offspring, and you take those offspring and you actually grow them in a mixture like this every year. under organic management. That's what this is. This is a gorgeous organic wheat crop. It's on pasture breaking, and that's why it looks so clean and beautiful. And you grow this population for 10 years every year, and you let it evolve and evolve to the circumstances under which it's growing. So, for example, there was a study in Italy where they took an evolutionary population, grew it for X number of years, and then gave it to farmers to grow, and they each grew it for about 10 years. And then they got samples of the seed back and tried to find out how the different regions of Italy produced the durum wheat and how that shaped the genetics of the population. And it definitely does. The value of doing this is that you can tailor the wheat population to the local circumstances on that particular organic farm. This has not been done in Canada before, at least not to my knowledge, and I don't know if it's going to work. I don't know if it would give us wheat varieties that would be any better than what comes out of regular organic breeding programs. But we'll see, and so we're trying it. So this population here has been grown three times. The first time by a farmer in Swift Current, Saskatchewan, the second time at our Carmen Research Center under organic production, and this year at Glenlea, which is just south of Winnipeg. And we will continue to grow this population every year here. And if farmers want five bushels of this to use in their own farm, they're welcome to contact us and we will give them the seed. This variety, these mixtures, the evolutionary mixtures like this, cannot be sold into the conventional market. They cannot be sold as seed. They contravene the Seeds Act if you do that. But if farmers have local markets for milling wheat, this might be something they want to pursue. So, evolutionary wheat breeding, and you can see a diversity in population. And by the way, when we harvest it, we'll thresh the whole thing, and then we'll just take a subsample of that seed and plant it again next year. The camera is now going to swing over to the north, and you're going to see our evolutionary oat population, because we're doing the same thing with oats. So we have these two populations which we're growing under organic management, hoping that they will adapt, quote unquote, to the production system. Maybe one last point. Sometimes people say, what if I just blend a bunch of varieties together or grow my favorite variety and let it evolve to my farm? That really doesn't work because the variety is quite stable. Once it is a variety, and you just don't have the inherent genetic diversity to really make that work, to really have a population of wheat or oats evolve to match your growing conditions, you need to start with an earlier generation cross, which is what we have here. Okay, thanks for your attention.
Hi everyone, my name is Victoria Smelko and I am a master's student in the entomology department at the University of Manitoba in Dr. Kyle Bobbywash's Insect Ecology Lab. My project is focusing on the traditional Indigenous intercropping method of the Three Sisters and looking at how that affects insect abundance and diversity. Behind me is one of seven of my sites that can be found throughout southern Manitoba and Ontario, which have about 50 Three Sister plantings within it. For those of you who are unfamiliar with the Three Sisters, it is a companion planting method where multiple plants are planted together. So traditionally, the Three Sisters is corn, bean, and squash, and there is also a fourth sister, the sunflower. Within my sites, I have all four sisters, and each plant has a specific role. The corn is support for the beans as they grow. The beans deposit nitrogen into the soil for the rest of the plants. The squash shade the soil to keep moisture in, keep pests out, and keep weeds away. And the sunflowers are there to bring in the pollinators. So in terms of the insects that we're looking at, we're looking for native bees and predatory ground beetles. This is a pitfall trap, which is what we use to catch predatory ground beetles. There is actually a container within the ground filled with propylene glycol and water, which catches the insects as they fall in. There is a chicken wire grid to keep out any mice or any other animals that want to go in. And then we also have a rain cover over top to keep the rain out. When we catch bees and other pollinators, we are actually catching them with a net by hand. We have other projects that have started to stem off of this project, one of which one of my students is doing, where we are looking at placing translucent sticky cards throughout the field, and we are evaluating what pests and predators are being found within the Three Sisters. We are also comparing that to the adjacent fields to see the differences. The purpose of this project is to not only observe the insects within the Three Sisters, but to more importantly, learn how to create a more ethical space for Indigenous communities to create their own questions, driven by their priorities, ways of knowing and being, as well as their values.
I'm standing in front of a new experiment that we just initiated this year. It's called a mulch transfer experiment, and the way it really is designed is for us to grow grain crops where the soil is tilled and to use the mulch from the legume growing between the crops to enrich the crop with nutrients, especially nitrogen. Now, if we were to design a system, when we are thinking about farming systems that function without external nitrogen fertilizer, what are our options? Well, this is one of the options. Now, if we were in the tropics, where our lab group also does some research, we might think of growing perennial legume shrubs instead of these herbaceous legumes in these strips, and then cutting off the branches and dropping them onto where we might grow, you know, cereals or cassava or other crops. So the concept is not a new one. And in fact, we have done research over 10 years ago to look at how much mulch these strips produce and how that affects, you know, organic wheat production or other crops that we're growing without any nitrogen fertilizer. So all I really wanted to do is introduce you to this mulch transfer experiment and maybe point out a couple of other things that have motivated us to think about this as a practical system for agriculture that eliminates or massively reduces the amount of nitrogen fertilizer. First of all, as we are experiencing this year, sometimes it's so dry that we can't grow our green manure crops. They will not establish. And by using established clovers, this happens to be alsike clover, a flooding tolerant clover, well suited to this relatively low land here, we are able to tap into deep moisture, deep in the profile. And so in a way, this kind of drought proofs the green manure part of the cropping system. The second exciting feature for us here is that by supplying nitrogen biologically without using any fossil fuels to fix Haber-Bosch nitrogen out of the atmosphere, we reduce our energy consumption in crop production. And next year at the field day, we'll be showing off our new electric tractors. So we'll be reducing our fossil fuel use for our horsepower to run this rotation as well. So the point there is we're thinking about energy production and how we can reduce fossil fuel energy in our cropping systems. So how is this going to work? Well, this is the width of our plot seeder, which is 4 meters wide. So we will seed a crop like wheat next year. And this alsike clover will recover. It'll come out of the winter and start growing. And in early June, we'll take a silage harvester down here. We'll cut it and move the legume material onto the emerging wheat crop. So that has the advantage of not only supplying nitrogen, but also creating a mulch to conserve water. And then after the wheat's harvested And we may do that this fall yet, because today we're at August 24th, so we've got lots of time to grow some more biomass. We'll also do a second cut of the mulch and put the mulch transfer onto the crop after harvest. So that's our mulch transfer experiment. It is something that is used in horticultural production quite a bit, and here we're adapting it to grain production. One final point. You might have heard of the key line method of water management, and that is where you try to create these strips if water is moving laterally this way across this field, it could capture that water. And that's actually exactly what's happening here. There is a slight decline in elevation going from my left to my right, or my right to my left. And with climate change, we are already experiencing inundating rains, 150 millimeters of rain. And that tends to wash things down, and these key lines capture that water and help to use it more efficiently. These strips also provide a biodiversity benefit. They're a place for pollinators to live, for ladybugs to live, and ladybugs will eat the aphids in the wheat or in the soybean, whatever we're growing here. So stay tuned, but the mulch transfer experiment. Thanks a lot.